I'm meeting my daughter. Period. You're
right. I will tell you in just a second. We're about to start.
Okay, everybody.
Called Ready, Set, Pray. So we do ready, set, and then pray. All right, so let's try that. Ready, set.
The Holy Land, the central hub for three major religions found around the globe. That being Islam, Christianity, and Judaism. Today, in this documentary, I invite you to watch the rich history, culture, and religion found not only in this land, but echoing in the hearts of the youth who visited. But I'm getting ahead of myself, so let's introduce them.
Hi, I'm Anna, and I live in Columbus, Ohio.
Hi, I'm Courtney Pittman, and I live in Columbus, Ohio.
Hi, I'm River, and I live in Columbus, Ohio.
Now that you've met everyone, I think it's about time we get this show on the road. But in order to do that, we have to go back where we left off, which is traveling. It's day one of our journey, and this is our first real look around Israel in the daytime.
It's a cat!
Where?
Right there, genius!
Oh.
There's Anna.
Did you have some of that,
is this video going to be for me and Anna and River?
And you.
Anybody having hearing aids?
This is our Israeli native tour guide, Johnny. Johnny is very knowledgeable about both the history of the country and the Christian Bible. And this is Johnny with our bus driver, Hadir. Hadir is an amazing bus driver in the very mean streets of Israel.
Please take care when you cross. Only the Catholics celebrate St. Elijah's Day on the 20th of July, and that because of the rockets coming from Lebanon, they didn't celebrate that year. On the other side, right, 12 o'clock in front of you, that's the city of Akkor, Acre. And remember that all of this is the city of Haifa. Starting on the left, the white building, that is the Billinson Hospital. Why it's important? This is the hospital that treated all the Jewish soldiers who were injured in the wars of Lebanon before they brought them to hospitals, mainly in Jerusalem. Right in front of it with the brownish tower, that's the central bus station in Haifa. And remember one thing, this station would work on Saturday, but limited number of buses. That was the agreement first when the Jews took Haifa with the Arabs, and they kept such an agreement till nowadays. Their son. So, and he's saying that he's praying for you for having his dad as a driver. 1 Kings 18, 20 talks about Elijah and the prophets of Baal. And the story says that Elijah goes up to the king and he's telling him till when you're going to stumble between the two. One time you worship God, the other time you worship Baal. Come and let's see who is the real God. So they agreed that they're going to build an altar and put the sacrifice, and that the real God is going to bring the fire down that sacrifice. So the prophets of Baal build the altar, they put the sacrifice, and they spend the morning praying, and there was no answer at all. When the time, you know, Elijah was making fun of them, why don't you pray louder? Maybe your God is sleeping, or maybe he went to the restroom, this is one of the literal interpretation, or maybe your God is traveling, what we know about Baal, that he was the God of merchants, and he used to travel with them, or maybe sleep, you know, all kind of things. And no matter what they did, you know, even the Bible says that they cut themselves and blood was coming out of their bodies and so on, that didn't help them at all. When the time for Elijah came to build his altar, he built it out of 12 stones as a symbol of the 12 tribes of Israel, put the altar, put the sacrifice wood, and asked them to bring water. Poured it the first one time, the second time, the third time, until the water starts running from all the sides. What he was trying to tell them, in other words, there are no tricks here, and you're going to see that my God is original, is a real God. And he had faith that God's not going to answer his prayers, as he knelt down and he prayed, and the Lord answered his prayer and brought the fire down. Immediately they went down to the Kishon Brook, and they collected the 450. As he collected them, he went down to the Kishon Brook, and he killed or slaughtered the 450 prophets of Baal. And then he didn't have faith, and he started running away from Jezebel and the king, and he went as far as Mount Horeb until the Lord opened his eyes, and he came back. Now, what you need to understand and know that it's one of the very neat stories, because God used the impossible here. And the reason for that is that they believe that it absorbed earthquakes in the ancient times. Now, all what I told you, by the time you get on the bus, you forget. But when you're going to go home and read the Book of Kings and other books of the Old Testament of the Bible, and you read about the seat of the judges, whereby the city gates, so this is where the seat of the judges used to be. Thank you. Jesus is doing such a miracle in the same area behind this hill of Moray that we see in front of us, where that full of town is, comes the area of Shuman in the Book of Kings in the Old Testament. So if you remember, the Shumanite who had a son and he died. So she hurried to Mount Carmel asking Elisha to come and do a miracle. And he came and he prayed for her in the name of the living God of Israel. And the son had life again, and he took him back to his mother. As usually women were in the back. So Jesus is doing such a miracle in the same place.
My top one is definitely Sea of Galilee, because that was just a whole experience in itself. The weather being the way it was, with it being kind of, it was rainy before, and now it was kind of calm and like a little hazy around, and it was super cool. And then
I see him, but I don't know if he sees us.
Safari.
Just went on the jungle cruise.
Second would probably be the Jordan River, because I got to affirm my baptism a second time, and it was with the same guy, Pastor Powell, which was super cool. And we all got to do that in the Jordan River, where Jesus had been baptized. And then
So when we read in Luke 2 about the shepherds, we find out that the angel appeared to them and he told them about the new king that was born. To whom the angel appeared? To the shepherds, the lowest of the lowest at that time, especially the shepherds who came from here. Shepherds who came from here, they were really unclean, because they were the ones to grow the sacrifices for the temple. And this is why we find it like it's very unique. The sacrifices were for the sins of the people, and Jesus is born in the same area to be the sacrifice on the cross for the sins of the world. Shepherds lived in caves, as you see over here, this cave. Shepherds lived in caves that in wintertime and in tents in summertime. Take your pictures. You see, I was telling, I think, Pastor Aaron yesterday. Yeah, I was sharing about me building a tomb, right? Remember? And I said, in my country here, this person, trust me, died this morning or maybe last night. In my country, within less than 24 hours, even we as Christians, we bury the person. In less than 24 hours, unless they got family outside the country that they're waiting for. There's a small number for a funeral, and usually it depends on the person who died. If it's a young person, whether you know them or you don't know them, you will go as Christians, I'm saying. So if, like, we had somebody who was young, died on a motorcycle accident, there were thousands of people, even they don't know the family.
Welcome to Masada, a literal city on a hill. Well, that hill is 1,400 feet and requires you to either hike or take a cable car to get there. It also overlooks the Dead Sea, which we'll get to see later. But actually, it's the last line of defense for the Jews in the Jewish-Roman Wars. And well, let's just say that the Jews never left Masada. Our next stop was Qumran. This is where the oldest Dead Sea Scrolls were found. There was also a dog there. And they also had really good food. And finally, for day four, we got to swim in the Dead Sea. Now, what you might not know about the Dead Sea is that there's so much salt in the water that even microorganisms can't survive. And you will also notice there are zero boats in the water. Why? Well, it's because there's so much salt that it will quickly corrode the boat and you'll start to sink. So, why are we getting in it? Well, because the salt content allows you to float effortlessly in it.
The Old Testament of the Bible, in Jeremiah and other books, that the Messiah will be coming back from the same place where he's going to go up, and the mountain will be split from north to south, and he will make his triumphal entry to the holy city of Jerusalem, and his seat is going to be at the Golden Gate. Good to go. And then there will be time for restrooms and more pictures here. And it's such a great teaching for the church. And Helena, if you would remember what I said the day before yesterday in Bethlehem at the Nativity, she built the churches according to what the Christians confess in the Creed, right? And it said that he ascended up to heaven. So she built the ascension here, but two birds in one shot. The teaching of the Lord's Prayer and the ascension. So that was really a very nice big basilica that was destroyed like others. No one tried to build except the Crusaders, and they built quite a big one here before they built up. Up there they built a small one, in which the foundations of these walls that you see here are built over the ones from the Crusader period. And since that time, the nuns encouraged people to bring their prayers and put it here. And we're talking about over 169 languages. The Braille system is also by the church inside. Now, if the church is open, I still love you, you know. So I let you in, but very quietly. Why is that? Because Muslims do believe that the Messiah's seat is going to be there and he's going to judge. That's the year of judgment. Ezekiel 44, when you read it, you will find out it says that the angel took him to the gate and he showed it to him and he told him it will be closed till the coming of the Messiah. So this gate is closed now. This is only 480 maybe years now, old, built by the Ottomans. Under it, archaeologists did find the Crusader Gate, and we didn't find the one from Jesus' time. In other words, this cemetery didn't exist at one time, and the gate of the city was much slower.
Come this way.
That's my girl.
No.
How much is this?
Aaron.
He's talking. Oh, we're at
come
the
on, go up the wall.
Is it river's
wall? This is amazing. All right, hold on one second.
Happy Mother's Day. Today is Mother's Day in my country. I just remember now. I told my daughter yesterday, so I'm good. But happy Mother's Day, really, it is today. Because this is the beginning of which season we are now?
Spring.
Because, you know, the Mother's Day is the beginning of the spring season in my country. And yours is the first Sunday in May?
Second
Sunday in May. the Garden of Gethsemane there. And you know, these trees are really a good witness, witnessing whom? Our Lord Jesus coming to pray here.
And then the trees that are probably around 2,000 years old and may have seen Jesus on the night that he was betrayed in the Garden of Gethsemane. That was just really cool. We weren't supposed to touch them, but I stuck my finger in and I touched it a little bit.
It's your birthday, right?
Yes, sir.
So I'm gonna spoil you this morning, don't worry.
And spoil me he did. Now, I could tell you about it, but I'd rather just show you.
Oh my god. Hey!
Oh my gosh!
Oh my goodness.
You gotta blow out those candles.
Now with that out of the way, we move on to a more serious note. The Church of the Holy Sepulchre, otherwise known as Jesus' Tomb.
Don't worry, they're celebrating Mass.
I'm hearing you, but I'm ignoring you.
Is there something you'd like to say?
They got rid of the timer.
It's supposed to go up your butt and around the corner.
Oh, true.
Oh, a skinny corgi.
What?
Right there. Look at that lean machine.
Johnny Angels, I'm over here. Andiamo per favore per qui. We have big waters for a dollar. But
the sound was more intrusive. Once I get used, if I be the winner, I'm losing. Coming at me with illusions, never confusing. I would've just said diffusing, giving a realness amusing. Never to be able to use it, there was no way to refuse it. Giving a voice to the users, but when I'm on in a moment, I'm piecing the vision. I see when I see, when I step on a beat, and I'm making a break, and I'm giving them all they can say, but I do.
As the lightning flashed and the rain pelted them, the disciples looked around in confusion, wondering what to do. And then they saw something on the water. Could it be someone walking on the water? It's a ghost! They screamed in terror. Every one of the disciples in the boat was terrified. Take heart. It's me, Jesus replied cheerfully. Don't be afraid. He walked confidently toward the trembling disciples who were huddling in the wind-swept, wave-beaten boat. Then Peter answered, "If it's you, command me to come to you on the water." Peter knew that Jesus had control over all the elements, even the weather. "Come," Jesus replied. So Peter began to climb out of the boat and stepped into the water. He was doing it. He was walking on the water. He could hardly believe what was happening. But then Peter shifted his attention away from Jesus and onto the storm. He felt the sting of the strong wind. He looked at the motion of the wild waves. And then he plunged down into the water. Lord, save me! Peter yelled. Quickly, Jesus grabbed Peter and pulled him back, helping him into the boat. Jesus looked at his disciples. Why do you have so little faith? Why do you doubt so easily? Jesus asked. Then Jesus stepped into the boat himself, and right away, the night became clear.